Hello, everyone, and welcome to One Controller Port Podcast. I'm Benjamin Yoder, here today to talk to you about a very specific video game, rather than just a random mishmash of games that I've been playing recently. I'm here to talk to you about Gungage, but I have a guest this week. I have Rowan from the Platform and Pitfalls podcast.
Hello.
And how are you doing today, Rowan?
I'm doing really well. I had a day off and I could just relax, play some Gungage, and get some things done.
Well, cool. I am glad I had a day off as well, but I wasted it all. it's not going.
I mean, you're going to talk about Gungage. That's not a wasted day.
Yeah. So, yeah, Gungage. I mean, I put out a video about this recently. So if you are familiar with that video, you kind of have a basic idea of Gungage as is. But I kind of wanted to go over it again, just in case, you know, you are coming in fresh without the Gungage knowledge behind you. So Gungage is basically a third-person shooter for the original PlayStation. It's from 1999, developed by Konami Computer Entertainment Tokyo. And kind of how I described it in the video was typically more in the context of like a third person shooter.
But it sort of feels a bit more like a rail sort of shooter, really, like you're always holding that button down as opposed to conserving ammo and things.
Yeah, I've seen that comparison. We actually had a comparison to that in the comments section on the video, and I kind of had forgotten that originally when I saw this game, it reminded me a lot of a game called P&O3, if you're familiar with that, on the GameCube.
No, I haven't. That was one of the Capcom 5, was it not?
Yeah, it was one of the Capcom 5, and it's basically, it plays actually pretty similarly. So Gungage, you know, being on the PlayStation, you know, dual analog stick support was available on the PlayStation, but Gungage does not make use of it, as far as I can tell, at least. The dual analog, or the dual shock support is only for the rumble, as far as I can tell. And it's got kind of a tanky feel to it in some ways. It's not really tank controls per se, but basically use the D-pad to kind of move and rotate your character and then use the triggers to kind of strafe. It's pretty similar to like a Mega Man Legends or something along those lines, I feel like.
But a lot smoother.
Is it smoother than Mega Man Legends?
I think maybe just the feeling of being able to shoot while moving that makes it feel smoother. Like Mega Man Legends is fast. But it sort of it always felt a bit like unnatural and jerky.
Interesting. I would say that I feel like Mega Man Legends is actually more responsive in a lot of ways.
It's probably more responsive.
But yeah, I do feel like that Gungage, it's like when you get moving, it's everything's fine, but but until you get moving, it does feel like very sluggish. Like it feels like you have like a rev up every time you start trying to move.
Yeah. It takes a while to go from 0 to 2.
Yeah. But the P&O3 comparison, that game is actually a very forward-facing game. So it's like a corridor shooter almost. Mm-hmm. And so it has a very similar control scheme where it's like you use the analog stick and that kind of, you know, pivots your character as well as move it back and forth rather than using like the right analog stick to change the camera. And then you use L and R to kind of like do these little side flips and things like that. So to me, Gungage in a lot of ways feels kind of like the prototype P&O3, but I had kind of forgot about that when I did the video. That was like something I wanted to talk about, but I really didn't actually touch on it, unfortunately. But I thought that was an interesting comparison.
When you say like it feels like P&O3, I was sort of playing it and feeling like this feels, and it's not really very fair, but like the way that like your emphasis on not on the aiming of the shooting, but just on the locking on, it felt a little bit like ReCore to me, even though like they're very, very different games. Like I couldn't help but think that there's that like, not lineage, but there's something there that links them to. And maybe it's also, they both look very good too.
Yeah, I actually completely forgot about ReCore, and that actually—
Most people do.
You're right. Yeah. I really want to play it at some point. I just don't have it's on PC now, but I didn't have an Xbox One when it came out. But yeah, that game is, it's an interesting approach because it's like here's the shooter, and it kind of looks like a third person shooter and in some ways feels like a third person shooter, but because all the aiming is automatic, it's more about how you move.
Yeah, it ends up being really a platformer.
Yeah, yeah. And so like a lot of Gungage is kind of like moving around enemy shots and stuff, I feel like.
Yeah.
The biggest problem with Gungage, in my opinion though, is that, you know, unlike PNO3, where it's like a series of corridors that you can, everything's just kind of in front of you, Gungage like has a world and these like arenas that you're in, and things just kind of sneak up on you.
And draw distance is not quite good enough. And every now and then there are some cool moments where shots are being fired at you just out of the draw distance, but it sort of like adds to a bit of mysteriousness and level of threat. But most of the time, it's like, why did I get hit by this? And it's not always good at queuing this, like especially with, there are several characters. And the first character you're likely to unlock, Steer
Harkabith? It's
hard to remember everyone's name in this game because they're all very, is probably enough of a word for them.
Very anime names. Yeah. The only reason I remember them is because they say them at the start. The guy who did Richter Belmont's voice acting says it at the start, actually.
Yeah, and also he does the voices in the Japanese version too.
Oh, really? I didn't know that.
Yeah, it's all the English, all the dialogue and things, all the voice acted dialogue is all in English in the Japanese version. And most of the menus are in mostly English, too.
Yeah, that's interesting. Well, actually, I got the PAL release, but the manual was like entirely in a different language.
The original PAL release in Australia. It's just that some games, the PAL releases had the manual localized for each region. There's one manual, and in some cases, only the localized version for a single region was in the manual. So,
gotcha.
So yeah, some games have all languages. Some games just have the language relevant to the game's specifically released country.
Mm-hmm.
Because those all language manuals were like really big, and I assume that people were like, actually, let's sell smaller ones that don't have all the languages.
Yeah, I was surprised that it was in default English as well in that case, since the manual was completely devoid of English. So I thought it would default to a different language or something along that lines. So that's interesting that the Japanese version also is just basically English.
And when you start the game, you get this like page of text that sort of isn't very clear about what it's saying, like the dark moon, blah, 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 blah. That's also in English in the Japanese version.
Oh, just all the text is also in English, too. It's just
that text is in English. The like little bits of dialogue that you get in the game world, they are in Japanese. That is the only Japanese text, basically.
Interesting. Well, I know like in Japan, you know, there's typically an understanding of English. Do you think, and I haven't really mentioned it earlier, but Rowan, you're in Japan. Do you think that typically people would have that level of understanding of English to properly read that easily? Or does that seem like a odd choice even for English in a Japanese game?
So there are two halves to this. So for arcade games particularly, they tend to have like a lot of the menu interface and things in English, lots of UI elements in English. And so since Gungage is going for this arcadey feel to fit that aesthetic, that's probably part of why a lot of the menus are in English. As for like that page of text, I think it's because the point of that page of text is to look cool and mysterious and not to be interpreted. Kind of like for a very different game, if you ever played Under Night Inbirth or Melty Blood, their screens have so much English on them that is like not really supposed to be comprehended. And if you try comprehending it, you won't.
It's completely nonsensical task. I've taken a picture of those screens before and like sat there and read the loading screens and stuff. And it's like, none of this means anything.
Yeah. So. And so I think a lot of that like story veneer is sort of really supposed to just like be vaguely there, but not really supposed to be interpreted, which I guess probably a good summary of Gungage. Like it presents itself, at least in the combination of manual and game, is like, oh, this is like a very forward-thinking game. We've got like the story, you can experience it from four different perspectives, mm-hmm. and each character goes through levels in a different order to uncover different like parts of the plot, is how at least the English manual represented it in Australia.
Gotcha.
And the game doesn't follow through on that promise very well.
It tries a little bit. There's definitely like bits of dialogue, but there's also like after you beat a boss, there's basically text that pops up on screen that's like, oh no, the military was here, I need to go to the next place kind of thing. But it's not very clear. Like Seer Harkabis, I think it doesn't really communicate that she's a member of the resistance until like the fifth mission. And then she's like, oh, I have to go back and tell the resistance about this. And so I was like, oh, apparently she's with the resistance, but I'm already halfway through her story at that point.
Well, you found her on a wanted poster. That should have been obvious she was part of the resistance.
Oh, I forgot about that part of it. So you are right. That was communicated ahead of time.
Not very well. And if you had to play on a CRTV at the PlayStation's resolution, you wouldn't have probably been able to read that it was a wanted poster.
Yeah. I think that is an interesting way to unlock the characters in this game, though. Like, you only start with Wakel Skade as your first character, but from there you have to find the wanted poster for Steer, the empty capsule for the science experiment guy, Divan Fang, and then I forget for Card. Do you remember how you have to unlock Card?
You have to fight him as well. I think it's if you just finish Walkie's storyline, you unlock him through that, but I don't recall. I never cared for him, so I never bothered to unlock him in all my years of owning it.
Oh, I think he's probably one of the more interesting characters because he has like four different weapon types that you can switch between all at once. Because everyone, kind of how this game works is that everyone has like a default fire that's typically like a rapid fire or a burst shot thing, but they have like special skills. So Wakel has like a stun shot. Steer has like these weird, I don't even know what they are really. She's like a spread shot kind of thing, and then like is it a shield or so like
she's
a
got
barrier?
Laser, Nova, and Mirror. I haven't worked out what Mirror actually does. I was trying very hard to get it to do something useful because I assumed it was defensive, but it never like reflected bullets, which is what I thought a mirror move should do.
Yeah, that's what I would expect as well.
Nova is just burst damage around you, and laser is a two-part. One button to put targets on characters, much like in, say, Panzer Dragon, and release the shots.
I forgot about that one, yeah. I was using that one for the motorcycles, because the motorcycles were really hard to hit.
Yes.
But, yeah, Card has just, like, four default weapons that you can switch between. So he's, like, a laser, a rocket launcher that, like, heat-seeking rockets, grenades, and also has, like, a flamethrower. In addition, he has, like, the special bullet, which is just a giant, like, supernova attack. So he's like really bulky and slow, but his like weapon output is just so diverse even compared to all the other characters. I was thinking about it today when I was playing it. I was like, I think he might be alongside Steer my favorite character, so I would recommend it. Is there anything in particular that you didn't like about Card that made you not want to play
I just him? Don't like his look. Like it's just very boring aesthetics.
He's basically Raoul from Fist of the North Star, so big, huge guy with is it a crew cut? Is what it's
called.
Yeah,
more or less.
Yeah. You should give him a shot. Don't let his looks deceive you. But I can definitely understand that. It does feel like an older, like, he feels like an older 80s anime character versus everyone else feeling more like a mid-90s, late 90s kind of character design.
And I do like old 80s anime. Like, I love, like, incredibly buffy hair, but he doesn't have that. So what's the point?
Yeah.
It's very shallow, my reasons for not having bothered with him. But yeah, but on that note, like, everyone plays very differently while still, like, being part of the same system. But what I sort of liked is that they don't commit too hard to this, but everyone has a slightly different UI. And like ways of measuring certain things, like what's her name? Sata?
Steer Harkabis.
Steer. She has her gauge goes up in like very small amounts. Like it goes up to like 119 or something is the maximum Tesla drive.
Tesla drive, yeah.
That she can store. Whereas Wulk has, I'm sorry I'm getting all these names wrong every time. Wulk has special bullets that he collects that are like in very discrete units. And I assume the other characters have like, well, Khan, you were saying, just has like four different weapons.
Yeah, but they have no ammo. So like they're like the all the other main weapons where it's just infinite. But his special bullet, you get one of those. So you can carry, I think, two or three of them at a time.
Yeah.
But that's also his only limited consumable resource. He also gets cigarettes for health.
Yes. And so they make an effort to make the UIs distinct. And like, Sata has, no, Steer has a radar minimap. And also the ability to produce a compass on demand.
Which is so strange. Because by the time you play her, like, you've already played through the game with Wakel, so it's not like you don't know what the levels are.
To be fair, to unlock her, you only need to see the poster, and then you can, like, die and lose. Like, you can unlock her in, like, 10 seconds. So she could be your first playthrough.
True. I didn't think about that either. Yeah.
No. But she probably is your second playthrough. That is a fair enough assumption. Yeah, she has this compass, and I think that sort of lends to the... It seems more ambitious than it ends up being. Like, you've got this plot that sounds like they're going to tell four different parts. Mm-hmm. They're going through levels in different orders from different locations in them. So, yeah, maybe at one point this game was going to be a bit bigger. Like, there's the plains level.
Yes, the it's like the green...
Yeah.
With, like, a bunch of bridges and stuff, yeah.
Yeah, like, that zone feels like it may have supposed to have been a bit bigger. So maybe it was sort of for those sorts of levels, but yeah, ultimately it doesn't get used. You don't need it at all, literally. But it suggests something about what was going to be in this game,
which is interesting because, like, I feel like that's at conflict almost with, like, the point we made earlier with the fact that it feels kind of like a weird semi-open on rail shooter. Because it is very much like, hey, you just kind of want to get from one point to another. And, like, the shooting mechanics kind of feel built for that, almost.
Yeah.
And so it doesn't feel like a game that, like, wants you to explore that much. But, yeah, you still have that compass there, and you're just like, there have to have been something here. Somebody made this at some point for a reason. So it is curious. I actually found out about Gungage because somebody mislisted it under the credits for... Konami Computer Entertainment Kobe, who worked on Castlevania 64. So I thought it was actually the same team that, or same studio that worked on Castlevania 64. So I kind of came into this game a little bit thinking that it was going to be, at least, like, the setup sounds very similar. Like, Castlevania 64, before they cut down the number of characters that were in it, was originally going to also be, hey, these are these four characters with four different stories. They have their own unique levels and things like that. So I think I kind of came in, like, seeing these kind of, you know, bullet points on Gungage and being like, this is going to be like a weird Castlevania 64 shooter kind of thing.
I came in very differently. I just found it in a secondhand store for $15 when I was about 17 or so. And this would be in, like, the late 2000s. So, like, well, like, PS3s, everyone already has them. But I was very content with my PS1 still. It just had great box art, and I was like, I have the money, I have this game that looks cool, I'm going to buy it. It's by Konami, it's probably fine-ish.
And it's fine-ish, that's for sure.
Yeah.
Which, actually, I'm kind of curious, because if it's not apparent, if I don't remember if I said this earlier, but this game didn't come out in North America. It was only Japan and Europe, as far as in Australia, sorry.
Well, Australia is part of Europe for distribution at that point.
Yeah.
It's only until mid-DS era, this is completely useless to everyone, it's only like mid-DS era that Australia, like, got its own, like, separate region for release dates on, like, websites and things.
Yeah, did you guys typically have day and date with Europe, or was it just kind of a vague...
We were, like... usually day and date with Europe, so we usually got whatever the UK got, specifically. But there was a sort of weird point in that, like, PS3, DS sort of era where... we would sometimes get things before Europe would, like, we'd get them closer to the US date than the European date because we didn't need the extra localizations and things.
Yeah.
But more or less, we're just Europe for the purpose of everything because we're PAL and use those TV sets.
Yeah. the 50 hertz, right?
Yes.
His pal. So.
Oh, good old 50 hertz slowdown.
Which made it kind of a nightmare trying to play this game for me.
Yeah, this is my first time playing it at 60 hertz. So I played a Japanese copy that I managed to source while here.
Cool. Yeah, I was actually wondering, I haven't got a chance to compare them, but I was wondering, because I know some PAL games will just run slower because of that 50 hertz difference. I don't know if that's the case with Gungage or not yet. I thought maybe that was because I saw someone running on emulator and it looked like it was moving faster, but I think that might have just been because they were running on an emulator versus you know, an actual copy. It's like, I was looking to import a Japanese copy at one point, but it was like $30 or something like that. And I was like, I'm good.
Yeah. I wouldn't worry too much about getting Japanese code. I think mostly it's similar, but yeah, it's got slowdown. Very few companies optimized for PAL releases. Like the first PAL optimized Square Enix game was Final Fantasy XII, I think.
That's late. That's 2006, I think, right?
Yeah. No, Kingdom Hearts. Sorry. I think it was Kingdom Hearts. So FF10 was the last slowed down Final Fantasy.
Gotcha. Okay. I assume 11 probably ran standard because it was an MMO, so they had to run at the same speed.
Probably, yeah. So it was running, it would be running at 50, but it would be timed correctly.
Yeah. So I guess the kind of question I want to ask was, like, since Gungage did come out in Australia, did you ever see, like, any kind of coverage of this back then?
I found it in a secondhand store in, like, yeah, 6-7 years later. I was like, this looks cool. I've never heard of it, but I'm going to give it a whirl. Because I was very into, like, obscure Japanese games at the time, too.
Yeah.
And yeah, so I brought it home and just gave it a good tinker. And it's like, this is pretty cool. And I realized when playing it for this that I never really got terribly far. Like, I'd always, like, boot it up, play a few levels, and be like, that was a fun time, and turn it off and put it down and away.
It's actually kind of interesting because, like, it does kind of present itself as a shooter in a lot of ways. Like, it is, like, a very score-based thing. And the game's only, like, an hour long.
Yeah, each playthrough is about an hour.
It's pretty short. Yeah. I'd say in total, it's, like, 4 hours to go through it entirely. One interesting thing I noticed, though, because I was looking at the credits for the game, this kind of contributes to the idea that this thing is more in line with like a shooter or something. The director of the game is actually, let me pull up the name here, is listed as Ueda Axhideo. And he's actually the lead programmer of a game called Axlay. So the axe in the middle of his name, as far as I can tell, is to reference Axlay, because he always lists himself as Axlay Ueda in all his games. Mm-hmm. Or Handsome Ueda in some of them as well. But yeah, he worked on a lot of like ports of like shooters and stuff. And this, as far as I can tell, this was his like first director or game where he worked as a director. And so I could definitely see that blood coming through like all his work from the previous years working on like Proteus and Gradius and stuff like that.
And as far as PS1 shooters go, this like feels really good. Like, it compared to nowadays, it's, like, out-of-date control-wise and things. But for the era, yeah. I think this is, like, very on point. Because even though it doesn't use, like, the analog sticks and things, most games of the era didn't out of fear of, like, leaving out customers.
Yeah, because the DualShock was added later in the PS1's life, so it wasn't...
Yeah, I had like, friends who were angry about Ape Escape. They couldn't play it unless they bought another newfangled controller.
I know people are angry about Ape Escape not being on the PlayStation 1 Classic because there's no DualShock controllers. So for that, I mean, like even then though, like even in 1999, you know, you can find that old review of I think it's like Alien versus Predator on PlayStation. And
they used dual analog that nobody understood.
Yeah, and like all the reviews were like, "This is an awful control scheme. Why would you do this?" You know, but it kind of became the standard. For what it was, or for what it became. So I think even if you had that dual analog support in Gungage, you know, it probably doesn't really fit the control style of the game in general. Like, I mean, if you want to focus on moving, you know, you'd have to focus more on precision and things like that for shooting. And ultimately, it probably would have made a worse game, unless they just stuck with the whole lock-on system, but you could use the analog stick to kind of like adjust your camera as you go. But generally, I think the tools are there for you to like aiming in front of you isn't really that much of a problem.
No, in general, you get locked onto the things you want to get locked onto. There are a few like environmental things that you sometimes need to shoot that you have to aim at, but anything combat related is usually pretty much, if you're in the vaguely right space to have want to be shooting it, you'll be shooting it. And there's not a lot of depth in the combat encounters. Like, there's not a lot of, I want to attack this thing instead of this thing. So the fact that you can't choose your lock on doesn't really matter mostly.
Yeah, and it's really just kind of about, as we said earlier, kind of like evading enemies a lot of the times. You just kind of get surrounded by things, and sometimes you're going to hit from stuff off screen, but it's, you just kind of accept it as, oh no, this happened.
But often if you just like vaguely keep moving, you tend to just like coincidentally avoid a lot of things.
Yeah.
And I don't know if that says something about like it was designed that way so that shots off screen were like less likely to hit, which I doubt in this particular instance, or if it's like, no, that's just like luck and the bullet's like always based on your position X time ago or something.
Yeah, but it's actually kind of interesting because like if you do have like a bunch of enemies in front of you shooting, the bullets also just kind of have a weird spread out nature to them.
Yeah.
It's not really like a straight line at you. And like depending on the enemies, there's actually like different speeds to a lot of the bullets too. So you just kind of get this like weird wall of projectiles coming at you. And there's plenty of time for you to avoid it because they all move super slow.
Yeah. It's very generous about like not throwing you in the deep end with its projectiles and things, which I think is really nice. Like a lot of old style games didn't really transition well in this era. So it's like, they got that, like it's slower version of Contra, of course, but like it, you can feel that lineage of Konami's things like that.
The Contra comparison? That's interesting. Like, is it like a 2D Contra that you're talking about, or is it like a 3D one?
Yeah, like as in like the 2D Contras, like it's a like part of their like shooting game legacy. Like it feels like a natural, like if you're going to do it on the PS1, this is what it'll be like. I mean, there were Contra games on the PlayStation 1, but I don't think they were very fondly remembered.
Yeah, the reason why I asked, because like after NES, kind of Contra's a black box for me. I don't really know anything about it. It pretty much was, I played the original Contra, and then at some point I heard about all the bad ones that happened in between, and then Contra 4 came out and everyone was happy about that. So I wasn't sure if there was like a 3D Contra or something along those lines.
There is, but I don't think it's a good thing that there was a 3D Contra.
I kind of like that kind of experimentation though. Like I'm super excited to eventually one day play Mega Man X7 as much as everybody hates it. But like I like seeing people kind of go outside of their boundaries, especially with like early 3D games in general. It's just like I know this is probably me being like an old man, but I kind of like that era of like late 90s and early 2000s. I feel like people tried to do too much with games a lot of the times, and they ended up kind of failing in a lot of ways. I feel like Gungage is kind of one of those games too, where it's like they create this plan and then they try to put it in place, but then it's like, oh no, this game, like the console limitations don't allow us to do this, or like budget limitations, like we're gonna make, like with Castlevania 64, we're gonna make 4 characters, then oh no, we can't actually do this, we have to cut it down by half. But like you get these weird little remnants like Steer's Compass and stuff like that, where it's like you can kind of see this vague idea of what kind of game they wanted to make. And it doesn't always come together, but you just kind of see like what they were planning, and it kind of makes it exciting to learn more about those games kind of afterwards as well, when you like start reading interviews and things like that and seeing like what their initial thoughts were and how they wanted to approach the game.
Yeah, and what I love about the series, like the rules aren't set for what 3D gameplay is supposed to be like. And I think that's really exciting, especially like I don't like shooters in general. Like, if this had a modern shooting control scheme, I probably wouldn't actually like it as much.
Yeah.
And so, like, all those, like, yeah, it's a very distinct game for its era, and it's very emblematic of the era in a lot of ways. And, like, it has these ambitions, but it sort of pairs them back to, like, be content to just be a good thing, but you can still see all that, yeah, left there. And I love particularly of this era, like, the monster designs, like it's very Panzer Dragoon almost.
Mm-hmm.
I couldn't help but think in the very first stage you end up playing, like, a lot of the creatures in there remind me of, like, they don't look the same, but, like, they sort of have the same, like, general construction of a lot of the Panzer Dragon sort of monsters, I felt.
And I feel like an extension of that, have you ever watched Nausicaa Valley of the Wind?
Yes.
I feel like Panzer Dragoon kind of pulls a lot from that.
It pulls a lot from that, and there's specifically in the second level with the main character, you start, like, there's all these, like, Ohm-like creatures around the tower, and they're like, they're not hiding it, they're more like human, they've got more of a skull-like feature set to them,
mm-hmm.
but they're very much like, these are the Ohm from Nausicaa.
Yeah.
And you're going to pull reference from anything, that is like a thing to reference. But yeah, it's a great style, and I think it really suits this 32-bit era, the 32-bit era limitations.
Mm-hmm. One thing I kind of was curious, because I put this in my review, and I don't really know if I found the right words for it, so maybe you'd be curious to hear if you would think it's similar. I kind of called stylistically, I thought the game was like a space western in some ways. I don't know how accurate that is. I more or less said this kind of reminds me of Trigun in some ways, and then so I was like, what is Trigun? It's a space western, I guess I'm going to call it that, and never found a better word for it. So I didn't know if you also, like, if you had, like, a better idea of like, tonally what the game was overall, if there's, like, a set of words you think kind of sum that up, or a specific style.
So I think it's going for lots of different things. Like, I think that, like, the first level and Wakel?
Wakel, you got it.
the first level and Wakel, like, really do feel like that sort of, like, modern, like, space western. Wakel really looks like a space western sort of character. Like, mm-hmm. I think that's a good term, and, like, you're fighting, like, weird aliens, this landscape. But then, like, you get to the ruins level that's, like, all, like, the water area and things. It's, like, this doesn't seem very space western-y. When you're infiltrating the secret base, like, that doesn't feel very space western-y. Like, I feel like it's going for lots of very different styles and genres.
Between each level, basically.
Yeah, like, each level and each character, like, you know, Wakel and Seta.
Steer Harkabis.
Steer. Sorry.
I don't know why I keep saying your last name, too, but apparently Harkabis is a type of gun.
If you've gone and learnt the name, you should just keep it all. But Steer, like, she feels, like, a little bit more like a modern-ish anime. Like, she's more from, like, post-Evangelion, whereas Wakel is more, like, pre-Evangelion in design. And then you've got, like, Khan is, like, you said, like, more 80s-ish sort of anime. Like, there are lots of very different things going on aesthetically in this game that makes it hard to pin down a tone. But its music is beautiful Konami rocking. That is the aesthetic of the game. It is just great rock.
I'm somebody who can't talk about music because I don't know anything about music other than, man, I like that song kind of thing.
It's hard to talk about it, but what I love is, like, Gungage has a slightly slower pace than a lot of, like, great 2D action games.
Mm-hmm.
But the music is scored like it's one of the most frenetic action games from, like, the 2D era. And sometimes, as you mentioned in your review, like, you're listening to this, like, intense, amazing music while just, like, walking down a corridor trying to find a computer to unlock the security system with. And it's, like, it's so inappropriate, and it's just, like, I love it. I love how, like, quiet and mysterious this moment could have been, that they could have, like, tried to, like, push their, like, story they sort of ignore a little bit more with, like, a great dramatic moment. But no, just, like, it's very cool music. Gotta have it all the time. Like, it's very arcadey music as well.
Yeah, and I'm actually, because the composer is the same as the really popular Castlevania composer. I'm blanking on the name. Michiru Yamane?
Oh, really?
Yeah, so it's actually two composers, and unfortunately, I can't remember the other composer right now, because they're not much of a... I haven't seen much of their credits, basically. But yeah, it's like, it's a very different style than what I would expect from them. But I mean, I'm really only familiar with their stuff from Castlevania, so it's interesting to see them be able to go out of that, you know, very specific, I don't know what you'd call Castlevania music, gothic music, I don't know.
But I mean, like, if you think about, like, Dracula X on PC Engine and things. Like, they do get, like, really rockish, I guess, too. Like,
true, yeah.
Thinking of some of them, like, I guess I can see where you would be able to go from there to here and it'd be, like, a smooth transition.
Yeah, I'm trying to remember. This would be post-Symphony of the Night at this point.
So. Yeah, Symphony of the Night was 1996, 7?
Yeah, 1997. This is 1999. I haven't played the original PCN version of Rondo of Blood. I've only played the PSP remake, I think it's Dracula X Chronicles, I think it's called. And I can't remember what the music sounds like. I would think they've probably reworked it quite a bit for that release, though, since that was pretty much completely overhauled.
And you didn't unlock the emulated version in that collection?
I did, but I didn't play it. It's on my list. It's on my list. I picked it up on PS4 recently, along with Symphony of the Night, because I need to go back to Symphony of the Night and revisit that game. I talked to you a little bit before the podcast with, like, A Link to the Past being kind of like one of my least favorite Zeldas, because it's kind of like the stock format and then nothing else with it, because it kind of set that in stone. I'm very similar with Symphony of the Night, I feel like, where it's like, this is the stock format, so, like, everything that came after it to me is always just better. And so I need to really revisit Symphony of the Night and know for sure if that's how I feel about it. But yeah, Rondo of Blood is on that collection, so.
I felt the same about Symphony of the Night for a long time myself, actually. And I was only replaying it, like, a few years ago that I'm like, actually, I do get this and I respect this a lot more than I had in my previous attempts. So hopefully you'll get to understand the true joy of it.
I'm sure I'll have a fun time with it. It's going to be more of, like, what makes this distinct. Sometimes when I go back to that stuff, something clicks, but sometimes it just is like, oh yeah, that was Metroidvania for sure. Every other game is Metroidvania now. So it's like, it's not a fault of the game. It's just the fault of the context of the game in a modern day in a lot of ways. So, but yeah, this, the team that worked on Gungage actually was, well, not the team that worked on Gungage, I shouldn't say that, but the studio, Konami Computer Entertainment Tokyo, actually is the same studio that worked on Lament of Innocence and Curse of Darkness, which I tried to look in to see if there was any kind of, like, staff overlap or anything like that. But unfortunately, I did not see much of that. There is some, like, artists and stuff that ended up getting shared between them and somebody, or people who worked on, like, specific character designs. I think each character has their own character designer. If you, like, in the credits, each person has, like, a listed person who worked on them. I thought was kind of interesting. I don't know how often that approach is taken in game design, where it's just like, hey, one person's in control of this one character kind of thing.
It does depend on the games quite a lot. I know there are, like, a number of games that do that, but it's more when a bit like this. They're, like, going for, like, very different things. And I know, like, Xenoblade 2 commissioned, like, a lot of unique artists to get things. And in gacha games, it all seems pretty common to, like, you know, we want a new character, we're going to get this artist to do it that isn't part of our usual team. But for this era, I think it's pretty, because the credits, like, it's almost the first thing in the credits, like, this character by this person planning.
Yeah.
And this character by this, like, that's very early for that sort of thing, I think.
And I feel like with gacha games, it's almost like a necessity more than, like, a choice, because there's so many characters. You can't obviously have one person working on, like, you don't want to just contract one person to work on your entire cast of characters in some ways. And so I feel like with Gungage, because it is such a small, tight cast, it's just four characters. It's not like, you know, 300 plus, you know, things. It is a bit more distinct in that regard.
And it adds to, like, that beautiful mishmash that we've talked about multiple times here. Like, everyone is just very distinct. The UIs are distinct. And their designers are also distinct. And somehow it does manage to be cohesive. It does feel like it all fits together, even though it really is not all together.
Yeah. So, Rowan, I have to ask you, in my video, I said, I think you could maybe play Gungage. It's probably a good, all right game to play. Is that also your feelings, or do you have a more stronger feeling for or against playing Gungage?
I think that if you want to understand in an enjoyable way what the PS1 is, like, all about, I think that, like, grabbing a JRPG and Gungage will have you set. Like, if you want the condensed, this is the PS1 experience of the time, that'll do you. Like, gotcha. Gungage is really playable by today's standards, but is still, like, distinct and in the mindset of that era. And it's an easy play, it's good fun, but it encapsulates, like, that weird PS1 sort of figuring things out sort of mindset that makes the PS1 a really interesting console. And I think...
And it's short.
And I think for looking back at games, it's nice to sort of have these, like, games that you can just be like, just play this, and you'll have maybe not the best idea of everything, but it'll give you, like, it's a nice window. And I think it's one of the best into that time. Like, when playing it for this, I was like, yeah, I remember all these, like, different experiences from this time that I maybe wouldn't go back and play anymore, unlike Gungage, but they're there, and, like, they are similar in senses.
Well, cool. Thank you. Thank you for that. I think that's, like... probably a more detailed answer than what I gave in the review, so that is helpful.
I'm glad.
I think I was kind of wishy-washy on it, because
to be fair, I think it's very easy to be wishy-washy on Gungage. Like, it is, I at the time, I think it would have been like a very fair like 7 out of 10, and you know, over time, like, that sort of gets magnified a bit. Like, it was average then, it's sort of average now, but I think it's average in like the exact best way.
So Rowan, one thing I want to do with people coming on the podcast is give you a platform to talk about a game that you don't get to talk about very often, something you want people to know about. So I was wondering if you have brought a game here today to discuss.
So recently I've gotten really into looking at the Pico 8. Do you know anything about this?
This is the line of Game Boy Advance games that were by students?
No.
Correct? No. Okay, no, never mind.
The Pico 8 is a fantasy console that does not exist, that has a software development kit and things that is designed for like very easy development of like short form games that sort of have like an 8-bit-ish aesthetic. So it has lots of like set limitations on how it functions to encourage like developers to make like cool little interesting things. And it's very fun just looking at what people are making, because it's a very like non-intimidating development environment. So it's very good for like prototyping. Anyway, there's lots of very cool little games. They all play in your browser. The guy, Celeste, was originally one of these games and then made into a more expanded version. I've been having far too much fun with a demake of A Hat in Time.
Oh, interesting.
For the Pico 8. It's just a very simple platform with like a very good grappling hook. And I can't imagine many people would have like gone and looked it up, but I'll give you a link to put in the show notes later. But A Hat on Time, a Pico 8 demake, is a very excellent, very short time that I think is worth tinkering with. And Pico 8 in general is just like a really fun experience of like experiencing like 90s shareware culture. Again, like when you go to a supermarket and like buy a CD of 100 games or something, like it evokes that feeling of like PC nostalgia for me.
Gotcha. And like, is it like a more dynamic grapple hook, or is it like a stiff one? Like,
it's a very dynamic grappling hook, so it's very elastic. So if you launch it while going down, you'll like fall with your momentum, and if you fall very far, when you bounce up, you'll go like very high up and things.
Is so this just the Umihara Kawase game?
No, it's not, but like, it is. I did not get along as much as I would have liked with the most recent Umihara Kawase game, so it... It's only a few... Like, this game is only like 20 minutes long, but it filled a niche that I was not satisfied with in the new game, so that's my strong praise for it. For like a game jam demake.
And this is a free thing, or?
Yeah, it's a free thing. You can play it in browser. Okay. You can find it on itch.io. Again, we'll give you a link for the show notes.
Cool.
And let's play with that and play with like other Pico 8 stuff. There's so much. It's all good. People upload it for browser based play. It's a great little way to experiment with lots of different little cool, interesting games.
Cool. Yeah, I haven't tried A Hat in Time yet, so maybe I should start with the demake. And play it the wrong way.
Yeah.
Of starting with the demake. That's how I did a Link to the Past. Start with A Link Between Worlds first and then go to A Link to the Past. So
A Hat in Time is also a great experience. And you should also play that too. But the demake is great fun.
Gotcha. Well, thank you very much for your time, Rowan. So if you want, can you go ahead and plug your podcast and any other projects you're working on?
Sure. So I'm one of two hosts for the podcast Platforms and Pitfalls. We're a game design podcast that looks at five games each month to compare and contrast how they all deal with a design idea. As you might have guessed from the Hat in Time thing, I'm very into grappling hooks. One of our favorite episodes is an episode all about grappling hooks, looking at Umihawa Kawase, Bionic Commando, Ocarina of Time, I'm going to forget one of these games, Devil May Cry 4, and...
Devil May Cry has a grappling hook?
The Devil Arm.
I don't think I know about this.
okay, grappling, grappling-like mechanic.
Yeah, yeah.
And I have actually forgotten the other title, and I can't believe that. Anyway,
that's fine.
That's one of our best episodes, even though I can't remember one of the games for it. But give it a listen. We talk about lots of different games. We're very time agnostic, so whether it's new or old, if it's worth talking about for our discussion purposes, we'll include it regardless. And you'll find us on idriseffect.net/platformsandpitfalls. We'll have a link in the show notes, hopefully, for you.
Yes, I'll definitely include that as well.
Oh, you can find me on Twitter at link6616.
All right, cool. And then so pretty much the normal stuff on this side in terms of, you know, onecontrollerport.com is the website. Also YouTube channel, if you want to follow it there. Should be some sort of podcast up this week. I'm recording this ahead of time, so I actually don't know what will be up on the website this week. But there should be some sort of content up on the website. And then if you haven't watched the Gungage video, I'll go ahead and link that as well. So go ahead and check that out. Anyways, thank you very much for your time, Rowan. I appreciate it.
It was a pleasure.
And I hope everybody has a great week. Bye.
Bye.